Howdy, howdy, ho. Welcome to VTS52 for June 2009. I'm your host, Keith Lango. Today, we dance. Dance with me. All right, we're going to pick up on this thing where we left off. I'm going to try and move along as quickly as I can on this. It's a very complicated piece of animation, and it's not something that you just can expect to whip through really, really fast. I mean, we're talking about taking a James Brown kind of dance, capturing the spirit of it, trying to break down as much as we can about the mechanics of what makes a James Brown dance feel like a James Brown dance. The very basic aspect of it is that there's a big contrast of regions of motion. Contrast is the key to all art forms. It really is. And to get great contrast, you need great control. That is the form of craft. There's two sides to art. There's expression and there's craft. If your craft is no good, your expression doesn't mean anything. Okay, so in the last 100 years, people have kind of poo-pooed the craft part, thinking the expression is everything. Well, I mean, if you want to actually express an idea rather than just have people come up with their own ideas, which I think is kind of outside of the critique of modern art, I think is intellectually lazy. What does it mean? Well, what do you think it means? I'm paying you to tell me something, but that's just my critique of modern art. Aside from that, there's two sides, the expression and the craft. The craft is about contrast, and the thing about getting great contrast is control. What James Brown has is he has great control. There's stillness in the upper part of the body versus activity or motion in the lower part of the body, and you see it throughout everything he does. You know, the amount of motion, just scrubbing through it very quickly, you get a sense. Just watch those feet and watch what's happening with the feet and stuff while the upper body stays pretty still. And even here, you know, the upper body is fairly steady while the feet are doing a lot of different things. And then, but he doesn't always roll with that particular theme. He'll mix it up. Sometimes he'll kind of bust in and out of doing something where the whole body is doing something together in unison, and then he breaks it into parts, and then he brings it back together again, then he breaks it into parts. That's a great artist. His art is dance and song, but he's a great artist when it comes to dance. So in that regard, we're just trying to understand the soul of this thing and capture it and express it in its own way. We've gotten pretty far with this. I've turned off his arms the last time we were working here, if you remember. What I wanted to try and do is get a sense of this character kind of doing this stuff, doing his little shuffle back, his pop-up, and then, of course, there's the turnaround business right here. And we got through the basic core of the turnaround. Of course, I didn't have the arms turned on. So what we're going to do is I'm going to kind of turn those arms back off. And I want to kind of finish up this turn and kind of get into the next little bit of this. We kind of got pretty much to the end of this right here, where, you know, the end of the spin is his left foot is kind of out, and he's kind of got this kind of this glide out bit right there. And so what I'm looking at here is from the next part after the spin, I'm going to kind of polish up the spin. There's a couple of breakdowns we need to build. But then it kind of goes into this business where as he comes out of the spin, he kind of does this little thing with his hips where his hips will kind of come up and bounce twice. And as they bounce, on the second one up, you know, his hands kind of come up here and the arms come down and all that stuff. So we're going to get into that in just a little bit. But let's go ahead and finish out the core of this spin. We need a breakdown between 21 and 22, just because, you know, if you look at this from above as a clock, he was originally starting in this direction. We've got this drawing and this drawing. I would like to create breakdowns here, at the very least, okay? So I want to build two breakdowns here because we also have kind of like this drawing right there, right, which is sort of a breakdown, right? So, and he spins in this direction, right? So I need to build these two breakdowns. One of them is kind of like at this 2 o'clock, and the other one's at this 9 o'clock position. So between here and here, right, if we were to look at this from above, All right, in this instance, he's pointing at 6, okay? And then there, he's pointing at 3. So we've got 6, 3, and 9. And we've got, you know, back around all the way to the other one. So what I want to do is I want to build a breakdown between here and here. So I need to build something for this part. I'd like to build something for this part to kind of connect that side right there. So we can kind of build in and kind of fill in the blanks of how this thing's going to spin. We got the core of it, but now we kind of need to put in a little bit more. So the first thing I'm going to do is select all of his controllers right here, and I'm just going to take these keys and I'm going to kind of create an empty space right here. Now the computer's not giving me much to work with, so there's a couple ways I can do this. One, I can build this by hand. The other is I can just kind of use something like Tween Machine and kind of guesstimate my way through it and see how that kind of works. We have this new camera angle here. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to pop out of that, and I'm just going to go into perspective to kind of get a sense of where this is going. And I kind of took this thing that Tween Machine gave me, but I'm not really liking it that much. But I'm going to kind of work with it, right? Because at least I got a key here to work with. One of the things that I notice in this spin is as he goes around from here to there, you'll notice the hip gets further along than the legs. The legs have maybe done about 10% of their move. The hips have done about 30% of the move of that spin around. So what that tells me is that the hips are driving the whole thing. This is not happening from his feet driving his hips. He's actually up and he's whipping his hips and everything else is kind of spinning with it. So one of the things that has to happen here is we need those hips to be more like that. More like the second one. Okay? And they're kind of let's see here, just as I step through it, kind of want to get on top of that. Let's see, get that foot back there and get that deal going. So this is, it's a tricky breakdown to build, but we did the hard part before. So now what we can do is just kind of work our system here and keep that in like so. So as I step through these drawings, we start to see that left foot kind of do its little slide bit right there. And we got the right foot kind of doing its spin and I guess there was a key that I did not set here that I needed to. Alright, so here at this one, his hips need to be kind of over that leg a bit more, and it could still be over that leg a bit more back here. Trying to quiet down the hips right there so that they're not quite so noisy in the spin. And so it's a little tricky. But again, it's all about controlling zones of the body here as he does his thing. So he spins that foot and then this other one kind of drags around. And the thing is, that's the kind of breakdown that we want for this one anyway. So let's go ahead and just get all of these things keyed right in through here. And this one, as he's back like this, now maybe we need to kind of do something here with the hips where they're... He's kind of bent over a little far here. Well, I really shouldn't have done any of that. So I'm going to undo that. Sometimes you get an idea and you start to try to do it. You just make a muggle of things. And that is what I have done. Okay, muggle fixed. So now what I want to do is that this one right there kind of create a little softer curve up through the body right there. Okay, I was trying to do that with the cog, but it was just this little. That's what you use independent hips for, is controlling silhouettes. At least that's what I found them really good for. You know, to kind of get yourself a good controls of silhouettes. All right, so as he spins right there, this foot needs to still have some of that aspect where it's kind of pointing the other way. My camera's kind of popping in the way there. So we've got, as he comes up, and he does this, I come in here, look at it through my camera. Let me go ahead and select my camera and kind of undo those keys or move them way over so I can kind of see this all from one view for a second here. Alright, spinning off that right foot. Left foot's kind of sliding back here a bit, which is good. So there's our 6 o'clock. There's our 3 o'clock. There's our breakdown between the two. Now what I want to try and do is clean up the head movement because it's really kind of junky right here. So as he comes back right there, I'm not going to have that head pop up so hard. I'm going to kind of tone that down just a little bit. And then as he comes through here, I want to drag that a bit more. Let's see, it's kind of dragging back that way, so let me kind of work it that way, like that. Comes up, pops too far to the left right there, so we are going to fix that by going like so. There we go. And maybe right here is, well, that's where he's kind of wound all the way to his counter rotation is going this way with it. So I don't want to move his head to the left there just yet. But I do think I want to kind of drag this back a little bit right there. Kind of soften that out with the head track. Comes up, then swings over. And right here is a good place for it to kind of dip down just a little bit more. Create a little stronger arc. Kind of dip it back a little bit. So we're kind of, I'm trying to create the head kind of going back and then doing that little number right there as it spins around. I think that will work okay. Yeah, that seems to be working okay. I'm sure I'll change my mind here in a little bit, but okay, so we kind of built that one, the core of that one breakdown there. And it's always a good idea to kind of just key your way through everything. I can't forget that I also got that guy involved. Just kind of key your way through everything to make sure you're not going to create some problems later on because you forgot the key translation or something with auto key, and then you end up, you know, get something in a place where it's not supposed to be. Like this right here, I want to kind of take the translate and just kind of start sliding it over a little bit so that that foot kind of spreads out a little bit. There we go. So make it more like the next one. All right, so now we got that one built. Good place to save. Not what I wanted. Doody 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 doo. There we go. There we go. That's what we wanted. So now we got that one built. If we look at it from the top view, we've got this one, and this one. Now what we really need is we need something this way. Okay, so let's see what that looks like and build that where he's facing the complete opposite direction. Alright, so let's see how this would work. What we need to do is again select all our controls and kind of create an empty space between what's 23 and 24 now. So I'm going to take 24 and 25, slide them, take this right here, and because my tangents are set to linear, it kind of gives me that as a starting place, so I'm just going to take that for what it's worth. And I'm going to kind of get in here and take a look at it now. Our knees are going to be interesting here because we got to get the pole vectors pointing the right way. Additionally, we got to get a sense that he's rotating on this pivot of this foot right around his toe right there. Okay, so what I need to do is kind of counter animate this foot to make it feel like he's doing that and get him up on the ball of his toes just a little bit. No, not ball to toe. Yeah, that's my problem. I want to use the ball. There we go. Okay, so he's up like that. So he's on the ball of his foot. Maybe he's up a little bit higher, because as I look at this right here, that his full extension up seems to be, I mean, his body is kind of right there with his head right about there. Hard to see in the video. So we want a sense that he's spinning on his heel here, okay, and then the the toe starts to take over, and maybe do the toe FK down just a smidge, so that the pivot changes from his heel to his toe, the ball of his foot, and that's kind of how it ends up, kind of like, well, kind of like that, I suppose. Right, so as he gets right there, and then of course, since his pivot is kind of working that way, his hips are going to kind of work back. His hips are kind of ending up right there, and they are starting right here. So on this halfway point, it seems that they would kind of get back over that weight just a little bit more. We would also continue the pattern that we set up previously, where the head and the body kind of drags a bit, although I might be pushing it a bit far there. In fact, I'm pretty sure I am. But I'm just trying to create that twist where the hips are getting further around and then the chest is kind of dragging behind and the head kind of drags behind the most. Okay, so as we go through the hips and that driving foot are kind of doing their job. This right foot could probably be in just a bit more. There we go. Makes it feel like he's spinning right here on the ball of his foot. I find it's just easier to just counter animate this stuff. Just pay attention to what you're doing and just set a key for it. I've spent so many years rigging things, trying to rig in all these special little controls. You know what I found? They don't work that great and nobody uses them anyway, so there's no point. Okay, now this one's a little bit weird because we're kind of going between what needs to happen at this point is this foot needs to kind of cross over. There's a moment, if you look at it, it's really, really hard to see because of the quality of the footage. But if you watch down here with his left foot, there's a point where it crosses over on the toe, and the worst thing about it is it's when it's off screen. So, but there's a point where it goes from the outside of the foot and it ends up kicking out on the toe because it spins around and drags. So there's a point probably in this breakdown I'm building where that toe, where that foot needs to be up on its toe and kind of drawing an arc around. So that's what I'm going to try and do, and we'll see how it works. This is, we're going to be kind of making it up as we go along here, because some parts of this will, you know, it just, now the tricky thing here is I'm probably going to introduce lots of gimbal problems here, and so we really need to kind of be mindful of that. Hey, that didn't work out bad at all. Okay, so you kind of getting the idea there. We can use this toe FK to kind of drag that in like that. And so since all of his weight is on his right foot anyhow, we can get pretty free with this left foot and how we swing it around. because there's a point where it's kind of sliding. You can kind of see it. It's sliding around this way where the top of the foot is underneath it. So it's kind of sliding on the top of the foot. And then there comes a point where that stops. It kicks up on the toe and then spins around so that the top of the foot is now pointing up the way it's supposed to. And that you can kind of catch it in a place sort of like this. And this is probably going to get rid of this toe twist right here. And make this minus 0.5 so it's not quite so severe, so it spins. Now the thing that I want to do is, as it's kind of sliding back here, the toe is kind of creating this arc. You can actually see it right there. You see how the foot's kind of creating an arc right here, like that. You can see it spinning. They're talking about his left foot. So what I want to do is I kind of want to track this. So his toe's right there, and it's starting right here, and kind of comes out here along the way. It sort of stops right there. So there's kind of an implied arc here, that a path that I want that's something like this. Okay, that's nice and smooth. So now that I've kind of figured out this implied path, I just need to go back here and just put the foot somewhere along that path so that it feels like the toe is kind of drawing that arc. And then it can kind of swing back in. You know, I'm doing this from a number of different perspectives, but you can see it totally works. It's a little off the ground, but we'll get that fixed. And then right here, I kind of didn't quite know where to put this before on this particular drawing, but now that I have that sort of worked out, I'm just going to have it kind of drag in like this, kind of create the end of that path. See that? But then I want to go ahead and get the toe twist in a bit so it can kick out. And then we'll take a look at our camera. Well, our camera, we didn't put it where we wanted to. But you can start to see how the mechanics of this twist are going to work out. The only thing that's really weird is that it does feel a little forced, that the foot would be out quite so far. So I'm gonna kind of tone that down some. But I'm pretty sure that from the angle that we're going to work from for our other camera view, it's actually going to work out pretty good because we're going to see it kind of do that. Now, one of the things that you can do here. This is a pretty tricky place to cut, in the sense that cutting on a move is actually a good place to cut, but sometimes if it's a certain kind of a move, a lot of it depends on the timing. And so, you know, moving the camera or cutting the camera here is one of those things I'm going to kind of polish down a little bit later when we get much further along in the shot, after we get something timed out, when we get all these drawings kind of spaced out a bit. And when that happens, I'll be able to kind of pick a good sweet spot to kind of cut it. But another thing that you can do is you can kind of overlap your cuts. You got to be careful not to do it too much, because it feels like, you know, explosion, repeat the explosion, repeat the explosion. You don't want to kind of start something, go back, start it, you know, make it feel like it's happening twice. You can overlap that cut a frame or two, but, you know, from this point of view, it seems to be working pretty good. And I'm just going to try and really get this working in a way so it feels like it's gonna work okay. Something like that is probably what I want. And then it can get up a bit. To me it's all about the shape, so I'm not worried about this foot controller being off like that. I don't care about the values. They really don't mean that much to me. They're only mathematical constructs, and that's just a controller to help me get the shape working the way I want. Okay, I can kind of polish that up a little bit later. So there, we've added that breakdown right there. And you'll see, you know, there's still quite a bit of drag and twist in the body. So as you watch, the body kind of spins around. I mean, it's dragging the whole way through this move. There is a fairly significant component of the hips driving this direction, and I'd like to have that somehow reflected in the upper body so that the head doesn't pop real bad from there to there to there. So let's go back to our first camera view and see what we can do. We built, if you remember, we built this going up like that so that it can kind of dip and go around for the head move. Comes up, dipping, going around. Right here is a good place because of that fairly significant screen left, screen right move of the hips right there. There's a couple things we can do. We could, if we wanted to, kind of take that back a bit and push this angle just a bit more. All right, try and create a little smoother line along there. So that helps reduce it some. And the other thing we can do is kind of get just a little bit more, kind of just do a little hinting down here with the torso to kind of smooth out that head move. So now the head's going to travel along a path that's a little bit cleaner. Getting to here, of course, you know, we could, we had built this for a big pop reversal right there. Between here and here, we might want another breakdown. I'm going to save that for later. I don't know that we need that drawing, but we probably will, just because of the complexity of what's happening here in the torso. I don't think it's going to in between very well in the computer, going from, you know, from that to that and then popping into that. I just don't think getting from here to here, the computer has enough information to make that work right. There's going to be all kinds of junk there. I could take the time now and build in a drawing for that, but I'm not really sure what the math needs to be underneath the hood. So this is one of those rare instances where I see I need a drawing, and I'm not going to make it right now. I'm going to wait till I time it out later to kind of put it in there, because I need to kind of find out, you know, I need to know what the drag needs to look like. And it's one of those things where I've got my head around this motion quite a bit, but this is one piece where it's like, I'm not really sure about the velocities involved. I'm not feeling real comfortable like I can just throw that drawing in there and know exactly what I want to do with it. So I'm just going to hold off a bit, which is usually not something like my students would be like, Keith's holding off? You nuts. He never does that. He always builds things out. Now you're going to notice here, from this particular view, the spine just looks like it's boiling and it looks like garbage. Doesn't matter. I am working from a perspective view quite a bit for this turn, just because the camera changes and stuff can be pretty annoying to work with. So I can, once I get the specific camera views in place, I can really kind of polish out some of those things. There is going to be a moment in this where he's going to kind of hold this little bit right there and for just a little bit of a beat and then kick it out. So he's going to like spin, bam. And as you go through this here, he spins and then kind of hits it out. And the thing is, it's all part of this very quick heel kick that he does. Stupid thing. QuickTime's going to crash on me. Yeah, that's very, very quick. And that little kick back in, that little ticket that he has there with his hit, with his heel, I'm not going to do that. So this is one of those moments where I'm going to, again, kind of capture the spirit of this. I'm going to have him spin around and get right about there. Hold that, or kind of ease into that for about 3, maybe 4 frames at the most, and then as a point of accent, just kind of, bam, kick it out. Knowing that, I can kind of come into this and hold it for a little bit. This is one of those moments I'm going to build kind of like the end of a moving hold here. It's not much of a moving hold. It's only going to be like 3, 4 frames. But it's still good to define it, because when I time the stuff out and I in between it, if I don't define it now, it's going to be something that the computer's just going to go, it's going to mush its way through it because of the interpolation. Now, this is one of those drawings that I feel absolutely confident. I know I can put it in there. I know exactly what I want to do. So I'm going to take all this stuff, move it back this way. Okay. I don't want a halfway in between right there. What I'm going to do is I'm just going to get this little tween machine deal right here. I'm going to set this like 96%. See that right there? Now I might back that off a little bit. And then some parts of it need to be 100%, okay? I did it to everything, but the feet obviously can't slide, and the hips are going to be a little bit closer, and the head's going to be a little bit further behind. So, you know, there's a couple ways you do that. You just take this foot, 100, take this foot, 100, take the knees, 100. Well, that's not at all what I wanted to do. I was on the wrong frame. There, right here. I want those and those all to be like 100 so that they hit and they hold. And then it's just the hips and the head kind of doing their thing. The hips, generally when I do stuff like this, I want the hips to be further over. So I want those to be like something like that. And in this moment, I'm probably just going to go ahead and drag this back just a little bit. Come hold, bam. There's that breakdown from here to here that I haven't quite built yet because I'm not real sure how I want it to happen. So this little kickback right there is not something I'm feeling I like a whole lot. So I'm just gonna go ahead and I have a lot of these functions right here hotkeyed. So that I show you the interface, but I'm not clicking on it because I just dug into the mel and kind of got it working the way I wanted to and made a hotkey out of it. Okay, in this instance, let me just do a little bit of the number like that. There we go. Kind of simplify it so it feels like it's not great. We can do just a little bit more with it. And as that comes up that way, we can kind of loosen that up that way so that the head just kind of eases in, but the body feels like it's unfolding just a bit. And then bam, hits it. So he spins around, hold, bam. Spin around, hold, bam. All right, so that's kind of the deal there. So now that I've got a lot of this stuff going with the body, the core right here, now I can kind of turn on the arms and clean up the rest of this move. Again, tricky stuff, so it takes a while to get through it. Okay, now the arms are going to be quite the chore. This arm can be forward a bit. So as it swings, it's a little up, kind of as it comes back, it's a little up high right there. So I think I'm just going to drop it a bit so it has a little clearer silhouette. And kind of take it back like so. Boink. And then as he spins, of course, this arm is going to be driving back through it. This is where I need to get in here and just kind of get it somewhere close. And then, of course, it's going to be dragging as it goes through there. Up. So as he comes through here and up, goes back. Maybe can start to swing down a bit. Trying to build a good drag in this as I go. Seems a little crazy, but it's easier to build drag in on these drawings than it is to go back later on and do it. At least I found that to be so. Alright, so if you watch this arm right here, actually I think what I'm going to do is maximize this view just a little bit more. coming up there, so that works okay. And as it starts to spin around, I'm going to start cleaning up this this arc just a little bit. Remember, by here, this arm was all the way behind him. Remember that? I didn't get around to doing that the last video, but at this particular pose, this arm is actually behind him by now. Okay. Probably drag it like so. And of course, his elbow needs to be back there too, so you got to get that like that. And no, not that one. This one here. What's happening with the other arm right here? This one. This arm is back, and this one is kind of to the front. So his right arm does this. It starts low and swings up around, and his left arm starts high up here and swings down and back. So we're kind of captured that with the left arm starts high, this one up here, and then swings down and back. Could probably push it down a bit more right there. All right, and at the same time that's happening, we can take this one and kind of pull it around, and I'm not going to have that dragging quite so much because I want to have a sense that that's, you know, being pushed forward more than dragging. Okay. So as he comes back here, this hand can maybe get a little cleaner on the silhouette. Comes up. Might be a bit high right there. Comes up. And pulling back down, it's going to have a little bit of a drag right here. Notice the fingers are going to drag back, and then right here they're going to be back like so. Flip the wrist, drag the fingers, and then a kick out right here where that finally turns over, because there's a drag and then there's the overlap. That's the two sides of the same coin right there. So this guy can be dragging those fingers even more. Maybe turn that over just a bit on the way back. And then, and right there it can kind of kick out. We sort of buy it. And then here's a place where we can kind of get this elbow to sort of drop in. All right. Alright, so at this point, now we can kind of get this hand creating its new arc going forward. So I want it to kind of swing up and around like that, his right hand. Not on that path exactly, but that general motion. So, alright, starting to fill in the hands a little bit here. A lot of stuff going on. All right, we're getting there. We just need to clean up some of this stuff. Stop and think about it, man. I mean, it's taken me a while to get here. I mean, this is several hours worth of work to get to this point. I think we're on our fourth part here, our fourth version of this. So we had the breakdown. That was one video. So three or four, about 4 or 5 hours, you know. So this is like a work day. I've got about one full work day in on this. It's taken us a couple of months to cover it because I'm moving at real speed. But you can see, I mean, if you're talking about, if somebody gave this to you at work and you had to do this, I got about one full work day in on this. I might be up to lunchtime by Tuesday, okay? This is a good place to be, lunchtime by Tuesday. Which means, you know, by the end of Tuesday, I've got this thing all worked out in drawings and stuff, so I can actually then start to think about timing it out before I head out for the evening, or doing the timing first thing, you know, Wednesday morning, you know, trying to look at it from a work week perspective, because I know it feels like we're moving real slow, but we're actually moving pretty fast on something like this. We're just at a tricky point of the motion that is really complex and took a lot to figure out. And so, you know, we're just kind of cleaning up the final little bits of that. Now, one thing I would tell you is, if I were given this situation, you know, if I were given this kind of a deal at work, I wouldn't wait till Wednesday to turn this into dailies, because it's such a complex move and stuff. But putting together this little reference video, I would sit down with my supervisor or the animation director and say, this is what I've got in mind. I'd probably get up and maybe kind of show them how some of that's going to work, tell them where these specific beats are going to be hit, and get their feedback on that before I jumped in and spent 3 days blocking it. If I felt really, really confident about the scene, like if I just got, you know, I could do this. I mean, I put this video together. It took me about an hour or two, maybe an hour, to find the footage, kind of think about it, plan it, put it together, splice it up. So it took me about an hour, maybe 2 hours, to put this together. So I get the assignment Monday morning. By lunchtime Monday, I'm going to my boss and saying, okay, let's talk about this. What do you think about this? They'll appreciate that. They'll say, yeah, that'll work, or no, that won't work. I get a thumbs up on this, I will disappear in my cubicle for 3 days to block it, because I'm going to be pretty true to this piece of work that I've kind of planned out here. And it's not made up of any one move. It's spliced together of multiple pieces. And even this right here, I kind of break it apart. You know, I kind of cut out some moves and stuff like that right there. So, you know, I'm creating something that's my own. That's just got to capture that thing. But I will go into my cubicle and just disappear for, you know, 2 days to block this out with all the drawings and get it timed, so that when they show it in dailies, they're seeing it, and, you know, I'm selling it. And I don't have to explain it. I don't have to put it up there with a couple of loose poses saying, well, right here he's going to do this, right here he's going to do that. When I go to dailies, I don't want to have to say a thing. I don't want to have to explain anything. In fact, I have a particular rule for myself when I'm in dailies. I go in with a pad and a pencil and a closed mouth and an open mind. Because if I'm putting something in dailies that I haven't taken the time to let it do its own talking, then I believe it shouldn't be in dailies. That's just my view. You know, you're going to go to dailies, you're going to show this stuff to the director, you're going to show it to a bunch of people. It's got to talk on its own. You know, you can't put something up on the screen and then have to walk people through it with words or talk them through it. It's got to communicate on its own. It doesn't have to be polished, it doesn't have to be finished, but it has to communicate on its own. There can't be any point where people are like, well, what's going on there? Or like, well, I'm not sure about that. You know, it just has to be what it is. So I go and I do this level of blocking, get this stuff worked out as much as possible, then throw it up in there, and I don't have to say anything. It just goes in there, and then whatever notes they give me are based off of information they have in front of them. The goal for me is, when I go into dailies, give them enough information to give me information. If I don't give them enough information, then I am giving them far too many gaps of ignorance, question marks, mysteries, unknowns, and the bigger those gaps are, the more likely they are to send me information that's going to really mess me up. But if they have those gaps filled in, they can ask for adjustments to them, they can not like them or like them, but at least we're working from something that we can grab a hold of. We can see it's up there on screen. They can be specific with their notes. We'll see that right there, how he does this. I don't like the way his arm swings. Do this. Okay, that's an easy note to fix. If I don't put in all the information, now I got a note that's like, well, I'm not sure that that move works. Okay, that's a really, really, really big deal right there. I mean, that's a note from hell. This move doesn't work. Well, what do you want? We're not sure. Oh, gosh. You don't want to go there. Show them what you got and let it speak for itself. Fill in all the areas of ignorance. Again, it doesn't need to be polished. It doesn't need to be finished. It just needs to have enough meat that they can understand what's going on. So that's my little talk about that. The reason why I talked about that is because I needed a break. Kind of let my brain settle. Alright, so this arm right here is going to continue its path back. Let me find out. No, you know what? I'm just going to quit you. So at this point, oh, that is crazy stuff right there. See how his hand, check this out. Watch how this is crazy control. I'm just now noticing this. Watch how his hand stays still, like it's IK, and his body spins right through it. That's nutty. All right, I'm going to try and capture some of that if I can. So as he gets back right there with the hand, let's get that hand to feel like it's... kind of staying in position. And I got to get this guy right there. I'm going to delete him and get him back around where he belongs. Crazy stuff. This is crazy stuff. We'll get this thing out of the way. I'll fix that later. Don't worry about it, folks. So that hand gets back there. I want it to kind of feel like it's kind of staying in place like he had it. That is nutty. And then, of course, we get that elbow back around so we have a good clean. And then this hand can kind of be like back down here again. So the hand comes in, it's somewhere right around here. Keep it right around there. Have it kind of pull off away from there. Okay, again, we're working in perspective here, so we're going to see this from a bunch of different views. But I think that's kind of what we're after. Might need to take that shoulder down a little bit just to help sell that. So how's this look at the new rough camera angle? I have to kind of get the final camera angle to polish this up a bit. But I'm trying to just kind of nail it down as much as I can from the perspective. That's one of the things is, if you animate through the perspective only, you have to understand that there's a certain limitation to how accurate you can get before you start chasing your tail, because you know you don't have a locked camera view to work with. So I'm just going to try and get the general idea here based off of a rough approximation of what my camera view is going to look like after the cut. And then we can kind of bring it back up here. And then what does he do with his hand right here at the end when he kicks that out? Bam! He's just following up that. He pulls it up on a nice little arc right there and just leaves it. So that's what we're going to do. He pulls it up, and then we're just going to do the same thing. Maybe leave it down. Down, and then up. So that arm kind of comes, swings, hits back. Ding, 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 ding. And we're watching the right hand here, or the left hand, sorry. All right, so there we go. Close enough for fishing. Or as I say, close enough for government work. All right, so this one, I'm going to go ahead and delete this keyframe right there. And now I'm going to kind of pull that around here, and we'll see what this looks like on this side. And the elbow needs to be over there. Okay, close enough. We're dealing with IK and world space, so things could be really, really goofy when you do this sort of stuff. So the arm's kind of driving through. Again, take a look at this just to get some ideas. Actually, he keeps the arm down as it comes in here, which is kind of crazy, but I'm not going to get too crazy about it. His arm, his hand is actually in front of him, down in front of his waist, and he kind of locks it down there to keep his silhouette really tight on that spin, which is kind of cool. And then his arm kind of kicks up here at the end, but it comes from down low. It doesn't swing across like this, but he keeps it down here. That way he can kind of kick it out at the end. So, you know, there's an element of that that I actually kind of like. So I think what I'm going to do is maybe try and capture that. Get that arm down there and kind of hide it in the silhouette. Keep that elbow tucked in. And again, keep this hidden down here in the silhouette so it's not sticking out. Again, keep the elbow kind of tucked in a little bit. Alright. Hands down there, coming around. And then here, again, it's going to be over to the side. He kind of spins around and through it. And get their elbow back where it belongs. Again, keep the silhouette pretty tight right there. And in this moment, maybe it just comes forward just a little bit more. The elbow kind of follows through just a little bit. And then boom, right here, he kind of kicks it up. So you get this nice fluid sort of deal right here. There you go. So you get a little bing. As the heel comes out, the knees swing in, the hand picks up, and the body reverses. It's a really nice accent. Bam. So from right about here is where we could probably do our cut, somewhere in this range. Because all this stuff looks like junk from this angle, because it's a different. I built it for a different camera view. So we could probably switch out on 23. So let me go ahead and come back here and select my camera and change all this stuff so that the new. There we go. All right, so he slides back, spins, boom. And let me hide all this. Let's see what this looks like. So he does his little knee wobble, kick, slides back on the shuffle, drops, kicks his left foot back there to place, pops up on the counter rotation, starts his spin in the middle of the spin, comes out of it, holds and pops out. Bam. Maybe what we'll do is we'll hold this one frame longer. Because the amount he was shifting from side to side, when we picked him up, he was over here a little bit more. And so the amount of his popping here from even that's probably, that might be a bit much. What's it look like if we can kind of pick it up? Yeah, the spin almost feels like it's over. We're losing some of it right here. So this is one of those moments again. I'm going to guess that the camera is right around here, and I'm just going to work from the camera view from now on, or as much as possible. My little section here, working from the perspective view, because he's spinning around in 360 degrees and stuff, I had to kind of use that a little bit more than I like. But I'm gonna kind of work with this for now, and then I'll lock down the specific camera view a little bit later. Bam. Bam. All right, took us a couple of videos to get through this spin, but you know, it's not perfect. I haven't cleaned it up all the way. I haven't cleaned it up all the way in a fashion that makes me say, oh, okay, I can just go ahead and hit spline and be done with it. But it is, the structure is there. I think I'm going to go ahead and limit that, kind of tighten that up a little bit. And then kind of pull that in right there. Just to kind of, now that I have a camera view to work with, I want to kind of nail down that hand so it doesn't feel like it, you know, so it feels like it's kind of being spun through rather than being whipped around. And the same with this one right here. As it comes forward here. Maybe start to swing that down just a bit more. All right. Okay. Crazy stuff. The head looks fairly clean. As it goes back, dips, comes up. Now there's a couple of things I can do here. Now, I like how it comes back and then dips up. And that right there is going to be a moving hold. I got to remember that. So from 20 to 21, it's going to be held for like, you know, 4 to 6 frames for a beat as it comes up and rises up through that. You can see actually taking the hips up just a little bit higher here. So at the end of that hold, he's up a little bit, hits it, pushes into the extreme on that hold, and then spins right on out of it, and then hits that and holds it a second, and then bam, kicks out the little bit of sassy. Woohoo! There you go. All right, crazy stuff. I will say that it is a lot of work to get this stuff figured out. I mean, but this is probably equivalent to the most difficult scene I've ever done from the standpoint of complexity. So you're kind of watching me really get pushed myself here. So I'm trying to work through it in a way that, you know, really really makes sense. I mean, I've done other scenes, like there was the rapping ant scene. This is kind of how I handled that for the ant bully stuff. I don't know if you've seen on my website, there's like these ants rapping for a trailer for the ant bully. I'm not a rapping artist. I don't really watch or listen to rap music or videos. So, you know, for me to kind of get into that, I really had to study it, watch the video reference, kind of get different clips of different ideas, different pieces of motions, and kind of put them together and kind of, I didn't have video reference to work with, but I had all these notes and all these things, so I actually got up and sort of acted it out for my animation director and said, well, what if you do this and do that? And he's like, yeah, it sounds cool. Let's work with it. So then I went in and just kind of went with this and kind of broke it down the same way. What leads, what follows, what's doing this, what's doing that, what's the mechanics of this, what's the mechanics of that, and just did the drawing-based system and went from there. So, yeah, like I said, I apologize for it being really too long to get through this, but you know, sometimes it just takes a while, and I'm still find myself tempted to keep you know, just keep tweaking it, because you know, there's aspects of this that you're always going to be, you know, you're always going to be fighting it. I wanted a little bit more drag on that hand right there, so it didn't feel like it was, you know, because remember, this is our breakdown from here to here, so I wanted that to have a bit more drag in it. And the breakdown's where I build your drags. When it comes to breakdowns, for those of you who, you know, need a little reminder, breakdowns do three things. So a little bit of teaching here, not just a bit of watching. Breakdowns, three primary goals. Arcs, or motion paths. Favoring, which is a sense of spacing. And then, really, drag, which is a function of overlap. Okay? Drag and overlap, you know, we call it overlapping action. It's just two sides of the same coin. Before you overlap something, you have to drag it, and then you overlap it. See? Drag it, overlap it. Drag it, overlap it. If you do something and then overlap it, it feels stiff. Drag it first, then overlap it. So, but your breakdown defines how much and how and which direction something's dragging. Favoring is, you know, if it moves from here to here, where in that continuum is it? Is it closer to the beginning, closer to the end? That's a spacing issue, so that your timing and your spacing isn't even. And arcs is, you know, is it moving in a linear fashion, or does it actually have an arc to it? Your breakdown, one drawing can define all three of these things. If you can get that in your head, keep driving that into your mind, and build your scenes with that understanding, you're going to be so much farther along than just kind of trying to in between your way through it, which on a scene like this you could do. You could end up what I call in betweening it, which is quite literally straight ahead animation where you are incrementally working your way through every little move, but you don't need to do that. Like on this spin, we did need to kind of work out, you know, all these various angles. We had, you know, he started facing 6, ended up facing 9, and I created a breakdown there, and I created that. So that was round 1. Okay, round 1 was yellow. And then round 2 is I needed to create that and that, and then this little kick right there. Okay, there is one more right here that I didn't build because I'm not quite sure about it. I don't feel like I need one right here because I think that's the fast part of the spin, because if you look at this on a continuum of speed, of velocity, it's going to be going, it'll go slow and then very fast, and then right here at the end it goes slow again. So in through here I don't need another drawing right there because that would just be in-betweening. I think the computer will be able to handle that, getting from this one to this one. I think it'll be able to do that. And then from there to here, the reason why I didn't build that extra one is I'm not sure I need that either. The only reason why I would build it is because mathematically I think the spine controls might not interpolate very well. They might just go, in which case the computer did a really junky job in-betweening for me, so I need to put another piece of data there for it to work with. Okay, so there you go, one more month down, and with any luck at all, we will get much farther along next month, and hopefully I would like, after one more video, I have a goal of getting to timing. I really would like to do that. This spin took longer than I expected. Humble apologies. But thanks for playing along. Thanks for coming. I hope this stuff is really cool for you. Hope we're moving at a good speed. And we're, sticking with it. So, good job.